does not want hysterectomy, although I would still try and ask her why not, because these many number of surgeries and again, but given the fact that yes, she does not want hysterectomy, myomectomy and bilateral permanent uterine artery ligation might reduce the chances of smaller fibroids popping up in the future.
So you're convinced over that. Vijay, any suggestion?
Yeah, I will also like to convince her for hysterectomy. If she is not willing, then I will go for myomectomy.
Okay. Are we trying to make these complex surgeries too simple by doing all these things? Earlier, we would just do a hysterectomy, finish it. Are we creating more problems for ourselves? So that tomorrow we are going to get a stump tumor or something abnormal on that? Possibility?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So one has to worry about it.
We have to counsel her that there can be a risk like that.
Yeah. So this lady, this was her story. The large mass was a parasitic myoma. And then this was the fundal myoma, which was essentially submucous. So we went ahead, got into the cavity and shelled out the myoma. So this was the thing we said about type 2 to 5 story. This is a typical 2 to 5. It goes right through. Take it out. Suture it shut. So coming to suturing part of it, what is your, all of you are convinced to barbed sutures or any other options?
Yes, sir. Barbed suture.
Or,
yeah.
Okay. Anybody using any other method? Would the you like to use the double-ended or the single-ended? Pardon?
Barbed sutures are the best, sir, because of its benefit, uniform tension, less foreign body reactions and all that. So, yeah, but, and also when it comes to multi-layering, barbed sutures is much better, and you can use a bi-directional barbed suture because it will save quite a lot of suture material. So you have, with a single suture only, we can complete the entire procedure of multi-layer.
Your bi-directional suture, any of you like the bi-directional? Yes, Dinesh?
I would like to take a bi-directional suture because it's for a long length, if it's a large fibroid.
Okay.
If it's a smaller one, I would take the one with single needle. And if it's a very small one, I would take a simple Vicryl and take a figure of eight and finish it off.
Okay, fine. Vijay, any other option?
Yes, sir. Now, previously we used to take baseline sutures. Now we have shifted to barbed sutures.
Okay. Sanket, any other option for
sutures? Yes, sir. Personally, I would prefer the barbed suture whenever it is available. But in case it is not there, I would prefer to do a suturing in two layers with the lower layer as a box suture. So a suture that goes from the posterior to the anterior and back from the anterior to the posterior. Only thing is you need to suture with the other hand also. So one or two of these sutures closes the bed quite effectively, leaving only the pouting margins behind. And then those can be closed with another layer. So that gives two layer suturing.
But
and secondly,
don't you think your figure of eight will do the same work?
No, sir. A figure of eight will not allow you to close the second layer over it. So okay. A box suture covers the base but leaves the top intact. So a second layer can be placed. And I have done quite a few cesarean sections for these patients in whom I have operated. So the rate of adhesion formation or scar dehiscence has not been there. Secondly, okay. As a personal preference only, I prefer the unidirectional suture with a loop at the end, because I think the bidirectional suture gets too complicated inside and tangles on itself to be able to give a good closure.
I thought everybody would say that, but I'm surprised some of you still want the bidirectional.
So in bidirectional suture, the other end of the suture is outside, it could not be taken inside the peritoneal cavity. So once you are done with one direction, then you can bring in the other ends inside the cavity and then you can finish the other side.
Okay. But that's going to be taking time consuming still. Okay. So sutures, everybody is clear. Single needle, double needle. Fine.
Yes.
So this is that same patient, the posterior myoma that was removed. This had a component of adenomyosis. So would this have changed our management on hysterectomy story now?
Absolutely.
Yep.
So we would definitely prefer a hysterectomy only in such scenario, but the patient is wanting a myomectomy, so that is our
You can see how that uterus is quite unpleasant there.
Yes.
And the myoma is slowly being removed. It's been removed, and we sutured that also shut. All right? And then finally, the myoma, which was parasitic, is removed. All right? Now, even this, I took it out transvaginally. You want to see that?
Yes.
I know many of you don't believe in it, but it's an old method, a very simple, extremely effective method. I've hardly had any problems. If you know where the rectum is, just dissect that down, and then you get the whole plane. You can take the myoma out bit by bit, especially when you have pieces like this, without any issue of the endobag at all. So you can see that the myoma has been, the colpotomy has been done. The instrument is passed through. One by one, the bits are given out. And then the larger pieces. That's about the only change we make. First the bits and then the larger bits. And finally, the biggest bit is put in. And the myoma is taken out through that.
Sir, may I ask a question?
Yep, go ahead. Yeah,
sir, when you do remove these large fibroids through the colpotomy incision, doesn't the post-operative fibrosis cause dyspareunia? Isn't there ever an extension of the incision?
Well, we've never had that problem at all, because we've had enough number of patients coming. We just take a single suture across, and that suture works out very well. There's hardly any fibrosis with that. All right?
Sir, up to what size you will take the fibroid through colpotomy?
7 to 8 centimeters, no problem. Sorry, my power went is going. Yeah. 7 to 8 centimeters would come. If it is larger, if I want to take it, I would take it out after cutting it into two. Okay. Fine. So that's the end. Follow-up of myomas. We are having a lot of issues with abnormal tumors coming up. Anything any of you doing about that? Dr. Dinesh, what would you do about your post-op histopathology of the myomas?
Yes, last week we had a case where we did hysterectomy, but somehow intuition said the fibroid doesn't look good. Okay. So I saw a frozen section and they said it is sarcomatous. And similarly, otherwise, in a patient who wants to retain the uterus, we get to know it post-operatively. And we keep the patient under observation. Nothing else is to be done, because usually these are just high mitotic figures, not absolute sarcomatous changes.
So first of all, you very rightly pointed out that the frozen section hardly helps.
Yeah. It's very, very difficult. You know, histochemistry, sir, in suspicious cases of myomectomy, better to also ask for immunohistochemistry.
But that takes 2 weeks. It's going to come only later.
Later, yeah.
Yeah. Vijay?
In the suspicious cases, we go for immunohistochemistry.
Okay. So, Sanket, any special management on this?
No, sir. Not too much experience in this field. But if I were suspecting a malignant change preoperatively, I may just consider doing a laparotomy and removing the fibroid rather than having a spillage all over the place, even if I have done good surgery.
Okay, fine. So that's good.
We can offer this patient hysterectomy. Yeah. If she is young, only hysterectomy, because ovary removal is not going to help, but hysterectomy can be offered.
This woman is one of those who's very definite that taking off an organ from my body is big trouble. So no way you can touch it.
An observation.
So,
Dr. Kalyani,
please with us. Sir, I like to add those patients where we are suspecting that there is uterosarcoma, then these are the patients, it's better to do a hysterectomy than myomectomy, sir.
Yeah, but no, in this case, we are not suspecting anything like that.
Yes, sir.
Just finally, to the hysteroscopy part of this whole story. For a hysteroscopy, if the myoma is larger than 4 centimeters, any of you believe in trying to make the myoma smaller, or you still believe in doing it hysteroscopically?
Sir, if it is like 4 centimeter, and in these cases, if it is a type 0 or type 1, yeah, I will go for the hysteroscopy, and yeah, I will leave that myoma inside the cavity. Okay. I will not remove it. I will try to enucleate and leave inside the cavity.
If you leave it, you mean, and then how will you take it out?
That will, sir, that will shrink out in a due course of time. And okay, in another 15-20 days, it comes out automatically.
Okay. Any of you support that view?
Sir, may I make a point? For a 4 centimeter myoma, hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes,
go ahead.
For a 4 centimeter myoma, that is type 0 or type 1, giving GnRH analogs preoperatively might be a good choice. One is to reduce the size of the fibroid, though not much of, not a very great change in the size of the fibroid will be observed. What will be observed is a decrease in the vascularity of the fibroid. This will help during surgery. Secondly, because of giving preoperative GnRH analogs, it has also been shown that the fluid uptake will be less. We will be able to operate for a slightly longer amount of time and remove more of the fibroid in one go. Right. Secondly, a 4 centimeter fibroid will mostly not come out in one sitting. So it's better to counsel the patient preoperatively.
Okay, yeah,
and lastly, if the shaver, the Bugatti shaver is available, then that would be the perfect instrument for this case.
I'll come to that a little later. So you will get a consent for a two-stage procedure. Dinesh, absolutely. Have you faced this problem? I'm sure you must have faced it.
Yes, GnRH analog I would like to give for a hysteroscopic large fibroid, obviously to reduce the fluid overload basically. And for laparoscopic, once if there are huge fibroids, say about more than 28 week size uterus, then I think it's better to give GnRH before so that the bleeding would be less.
What about cervical softening?
Yeah.
Believe in it or don't believe in it?
Sir, it's not required, because if this big is the cervical submucous fibroid, the cervix is usually open.
Okay. Mala?
The advantage of GnRH is also that it makes the fibroids very soft, especially for hysteroscopic myomectomy. I think when the fibroid is soft, it is much easier for us to resect. So,
but
course,
remember, with the fibroid becoming soft, the uterus also gets soft.
Yeah, we have to be very cautious.
You will perforate the uterus much faster. Yes or no?
That is also
clear. Kalyan, you have come? Hello? Oh, not there. Okay. Yeah. Silesh?
Sir, I am using misoprostol regularly.
No problem of perforation of the uterus?
No, sir. Not at all.
I've done it, that's why I'm quite worried. What about the use of vasopressin while using hysteroscopically?
Yes, sir. Yes, we use it.
Yes, sir.
It is useful, sir.
It's very useful.
It is useful.
Good. And when you go for hysteroscopy, any particular thing in the hysteroscopy setup you're worried about every time? The pump or the camera or the scope, or you want your favorite theater boy to help be there always?
Everything.
Yes. Everything. I think
the proper team who is going to look after the fluid management also.
Okay.
And the collection of the liquid, whatever in the bucket.
Fine.
Everything has to be set up before we start, right, including the cable, the cautery, and the camera. And everything has to be ready before.
Bipolar.
And choice of anesthetist.
Okay.
The anesthetist should be very friendly there and should be not looking on in the mobile and looking at the patient.
All use bipolar only? Anybody using unipolar?
No.
For very small, we can use bipolar is in the,
yep,
other theater, then we can go have a monopole.
Okay.
For a polyp, for small fibroid.
Apart from that, the theater boy also should be smart enough to inform us as the fluid is getting emptied.
Yeah.
So he should not allow the air to get inside.
Air to get in.
He should be smart enough to tell us as we are operating when the fluid is going to be completely.
That's the important thing. See, each time you land in trouble, you become more and more clever to improve your setup. So your location, the limits of your surgery, one would say the location, submucous, yes, partly intramural, you have already said. Size below 5 centimeters, What about below 10 centimeters? Would you like to still keep doing hysteroscopically?
I have done once only, a 7 centimeter, but again, that was a very pedunculated fibroid. So just cut it and left in the cavity.
What about the number of fibroids? 5, 6, 7, no problem?
So I think it is not just the size of the fibroid, but the total number of fibroids matters because it is the total mass that is resected which we are considering. Unlike a laparoscopic myomectomy where the diameter of 3 centimeters or 4 centimeters does not matter much, here because you are resecting the volume which is equal to the cube of the radius.
The diameter
is only twice the radius. Here it is the cube of the radius. So when we are removing a factor of pi r cube, the mass is to be shelled out. So you can actually add 2-3 centimeters fibroids and consider that you are removing a 6 centimeter fibroid hysteroscopically.
Again, more sir, if you are removing the opposing fibroids, then that will cause more of adhesions following the surgery.
Okay.
So one should be very cautious to take that multiple fibroids in hysteroscopy.
Okay.
In one sitting.
Fine. So that's good. What about the fluid overload, Dinesh? You were telling us about that. How often do you get it checked? Every 10 minutes, 15 minutes?
I check it every 15 minutes, and I don't know whether all will agree or not. After about, say, I finish midpoint of the fibroid, I like to give IV Lasix also, 20 mg.
Okay.
And keep on checking the fluid every 10-15 minutes. After 1 hour, it will be checked every 10 minutes at least.
So about incomplete removal, Vijay has already told us that he doesn't mind leaving something inside.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine.
But whenever, sir, you are leaving something inside, you have to be sure that you have removed the pedunculated part. What Vijay sir is talking is about the experimentation done by Sergio, where he just cuts the peduncle and leave it behind so that this will shrink and come out after some days.
Yes.
No, the pedicle. My only small worry is how do you explain that to the patient?
Counseling is
very pain and bleeding at that time.
Yes, counseling is very important. At the end of the procedure, we have to tell them that they will have some amount of pain because as the mass is trying to extrude itself out, there will be severe back pain they will have and also some amount of bleeding, and they will also be expelling tissues. So most of the time,
they counsel all that
when they see such
things. Counseling beforehand, not only sir, after. We have to do beforehand that we are going to leave it and we have to explain them that it will come out.
Let's have a few words about morcellation of the myoma. Sanket is an expert on it. Let's get him to talk us.
No, sir. Hardly.
Brand.
I'm hardly an expert. I have used a few demo machines that stores had supplied, but it is a fantastic instrument. In particularly in cases where the fibroid is type 0 or type 1 and exceeds 3 centimeters in size, it is the instrument of choice. Because the surgery can be completed in under 15 minutes with hardly any fluid overload. And the best thing is that we don't go near the uterine wall. We don't burrow into the uterine wall. So we don't open up any venous channels.
Right.
The positive pressure is not enough to drive the fluid and cause fluid overload. So even a very large fibroid can be completed comfortably without any problem.
But the disadvantage is the type 0.
Yes.
We have it in our hospital and we are hardly using it because the blade gets bad very fast.
Okay.
And it's a slow process, especially for a larger fibroid, which is the harder one. We are just not able to finish with this, and we'll go ahead and do a cutting loop that is much better.
Much
faster also.
Okay. Would you like to counter that, Sanket, if it is hard myoma?
No, sir. I don't have too much of expertise because of I haven't had that many number of cases. But for the 3 or 4 cases that I did, I found that it was easier to leave the blade touching the fibroid and give it more time to cut through the fibroid, which eventually shells the pieces out, rather than expecting it to pull it out on contact, which does not happen.
So the last line which I've written, if it were cheaper, would you use it?
Yes.
All of you would use it.
Yeah.
I'm happy with that. This was one of the sad stories. 24-year-old, unmarried, severe bleeding, multiple myomas, had open myomectomy with uterine artery occlusion. Following that, she was given GnRH analogs. Myomas recurred. MRI guided FUS was done. She was then given uliprostol and mifepristone. If you go through that, she's gone through every treatment in fibroid. There's nothing else I could think of. No symptomatic relief. Came again with bleeding. Uterus 20 week size with multiple myomas. What would you like to do other than refer to your enemy? Any other choices?
I don't know, sir. Uterine artery embolization will help or not? No
I
idea.
Don't, it didn't help in this case. That's why I was telling, who was that? Sanket, you told us, no, uterine artery occlusion. It works in some cases, it doesn't work in some. We have had that experience. Absolutely. I used to believe in doing uterine artery occlusion for multiple myomas, but it's not worked in all the cases. The important thing with this girl is we took the myomas out. It was a whole bucket full of myomas.
Sir, just you tell us. Yeah. From our side, in this case.
No. Yes. You are the panel, sir.
Surrender.
Sir, I think the counseling of such patient is very important that she has recurrent myomas. We need to do myomectomy again with whatever myomas are there. We have to remove it. Maybe for fertility preservation, she can undergo oocyte retrieval or something, this procedure. And then if she has multiple myomas happening again and again, might require hysterectomy. She can go with her own oocytes surrogacy or something.
We have to be prepared to the near impossible cases also.
Okay. Such cases, I would like to go by laparotomy so that I can feel even the smaller seedlings and remove whatever we can feel.
Yeah, but there are too many. Some of them, every centimeter is a myoma. There's nothing you can do with that. What problems have you all had after myomectomy? Instead of me asking, you guys can tell it me. Bleeding, pain, collapse, death, amenorrhea, infertility. I've seen all these things. I can tell you one death story of a patient, a recurrent myomectomy. Patient was operated. The surgeon took all the care possible. Patient passed motion, third post-op day, went home, came back after surgery on the fifth post-op day. Distension of abdomen, shoulder pain, and they did laparotomy, found sigmoid perforation. Same was sutured. Second post-op day, patient died. So you can see horrible things happen. Any problems you would like to share with us?
So infection.
We have to conclude now.
Yes?
Patients must be kept first thing in the morning so that the whole team is fresh and we can do the best. And if any complication can be recognized at the same time.
Okay, so the team is very important. Yes.
Multiple fibroids, it is always better to put a drace because sometimes there may be some ooze here and there. So you will have an idea whether exactly she is comfortable in the post-operative period.
Yep.
Because many a times when we do this multiple myomectomy is what we have problems. Like after a week or something, they come with pain and fever. So because of if you don't put the drain. So the same situation, if you had put the drain, then we could have identified. And if there is some collection, we could have tackled it or done something for it at that point of time itself before discharging. So drain plays a very major role in case of multiple myomectomy.
Sailesh, any opinion? Any problems you had?
There are similar problems. Patient collapsed on day third. And I kept a drain, as madam said. So there were problems, but it was actually pulmonary embolism or something like that. The patient was transfused some 6 to 7 units post-operatively also.
Sanket, any suggestions, any problems?
The only persistent problem that I had earlier was pain at the morcellator port site and post-operative infection before started autoclaving the outer sheath of the morcellator that we put inside.
Okay.
With that, most of the problems have stopped. Sometimes the pain, the neurological pain after closing the lower left port site still remains, for which now we generally take the incision a little higher than before. that avoids the nerve in that area. And I think there are some surgeons doing mausulation from the center port also, though I have no experience.
Any of you have had that problem?
Yeah, so that can be avoided. That is there. So, commonest site of pain is only the maxillary side port.
Okay.
So, it is always better to suture it in such a way we loosen the suture a little bit. You should not put it too tight. It's just gentle approximation is what is needed.
That's then very good.
That can be taken care of. So, I would like to share one important complication, sir, for lap myomectomy. A 40-year-old lady. Postoperatively, the report came only as leiomyoma, but then 6 months later, she comes with a severe pain and mass, and it turned out to be a leiomyosarcoma. But then postoperatively, it was only a leiomyoma.
So that's again a big issue.
But luckily for that patient, I had done an in-bag mausulation. So when she went for an opinion, of course, when complications arise, they definitely go all over the place. So luckily, all the oncosurgeons told them like whatever is to be done, like even in-bag mausulation has been done for this patient. So that is one thing we never know, whether we are really dealing with a leiomyoma, leiomyosarcoma.
But if you look back into the old histopathology, you'll find your pathologist now saying that must have been a leiomyoma then itself.
Yeah, so but after that, it was all the slides were reviewed. Even the slides were sent to the oncosurgeons who also said it was only a leiomyoma.
Any of you have had a rupture following a myomectomy? No.
No.
Okay. So all of you are suturing so well. I just want to show you one rupture which has been reported in literature, where on a routine scan at 28 weeks, they found a loop of cord outside the uterus. So they did a laparotomy, found the loop of cord outside, delivered the baby, and found that it had was a rupture at the old sort of incision which was done in the lower plane. It was not the cesarean, it's the myomectomy scar. Fine. So I think with that, I've come to the end of my story. Any questions?
Sir, one question.
Maybe?
Sir, can I ask one question?
Yes.
Sir, I prefer that if you have more than 4 or 5 fibroids, I prefer laparotomy. Do you all people also doing the same? I prefer more than 5 fibroids, I prefer laparotomy.
You prefer laparotomy, okay. Okay, would the panel like to answer it? 5 fibroids or 10 fibroids?
If it is a very huge myoma, mainly the duration of surgery. See, any myomectomy which is going to take more than 3 hours, I think we have to really decide. So at the
point... 3 hours, Mala, you feel hungry after that?
No, sir, there's no point. Sir. After that, we are also exhausted. So, the moment you put your scope and you know that these fibroids is definitely deep, seated fibroids, intramural fibroids are definitely going to take a lot of time. Okay. So, in such a scenario, it is always better, you know, to do a laparotomy. So, we have to decide early.
Vijay,
so I think I slightly differ with Mala.
You're actually after 3 hours, anesthetist starts shouting.
Sir, I actually differ with Dr. Mala. If you are doing such bigger fibroids, then you can take another friend of you who to be assistant so that one part of suturing you can do and mausulation part can be done by another person.
I think that's a good idea. More teamwork, yes. Because patient benefits. Yes, sir. Dinesh, I'm sure you're doing these big fibroids, multiple fibroids.
I think if they are subserous fibroids, easily located, we can do many in single incision. We can do more. But if they are small, class 3 fibroids, class 2 fibroids, then I think open is better so that we can palpate and remove them. The number of fibroids you had shown, I would like to go by laparotomy.
Okay. Any other questions, please?
Sir, have you ever done in-situ mausulation?
Yes.
Have you, because with your vast experience, have you done in-situ mausulation?
I have had to do it just about 2 times when I just couldn't dissect the myoma, which was going deep down intramural. So what we did was decrease the size of the myoma in-situ, made it small, and then the remnant portion we could dissect down below. So that was the only situation where I thought in-situ works out. And then, of course, the second time was when it was actually an adenomyoma. We found we could not dissect. It became an issue. We had to do that. Okay?
Yeah.
Yes. Any other questions?
So there is one question. Where to put vasopressin in hysteroscopic myomectomy?
Yeah. Yes, Sanket, you can reply that.
Sir, it's better to put at around 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock. These are the positions.
Yeah, go ahead. 4 o'clock and 7. 4 and 7.
Yes, sir. 4 and 7. There was a question in the chat box, sir. Yeah.
Okay. You're very particular about evening time, 4 and 7 always?
Sir, nowadays we are putting directly into the myoma with the help of this ovum puncture needle.
No. That is, you're talking of laparoscopy.
No. Through the hysteroscope, sir.
Hysteroscopy also, directly into that. Okay.
Yeah. You can be the...
American teaching was to put it around the cervix. You can, where you put it, it does not matter. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So 4 and 7 is fitted into that. That's okay. Right. Any other question, please?
Yes, sir.
So with that, I think I must thank Sushila and her team. The conclusion we said right at the beginning, you've helped me in choosing carefully. You helped me in planning the surgery. You helped me to reduce the blood loss. You helped me to remove the tissue carefully and the wound strength at lap myomectomy. So we've gone through everything we thought we could do. Thanks to the team, Sushila, and the Durbin team for helping me with the panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir,
for taking such elaborative panel and clarifying all the doubts regarding the myoma surgery. And thank you all the panelists being participant in this and sharing your thoughts about the myomas. And it was a wonderful panel. Now we are moving to next session, that is hysterectomy. Do it ease, not cease, even in the difficult situations. And we have eminent speakers with us for this session. Dr. Pandit Palashkar, Dr. Meenakshi Goyal, and Dr. Deepak Limbachia. And basic TLH, how we do, I am demonstrating. And Dr. Dinesh Kansal is going to chair the session. Kansal ma'am, please take over the session.
Okay.
Yeah. We are a little late on the time, so I am just requesting all the speakers, please stick to the timeline, and if you can decrease little time, that will be beneficial to the other remnant speakers. So I will take 15 minutes.
My pleasure. It's nice to chair this session. I got to know right now from you. So could you just tell me who is the first speaker so that I can give the introduction?
I'm the first speaker.
Okay. So Sushila is a great friend. She's the young, dynamic person. I think she doesn't have a parallel in India, I can say. And she's queen, she's the laparoscopic queen of Rajasthan. That's how she's known. And I'm very proud of her. She operated in my annual workshop also, Delhi Gynae Endoscopy Society. And I think she got so many applause from everybody. And I'm really proud to be friend of Sushila. So your topic, Sushila, today is TLH.
Basic tips and tricks for TLH.
Tips and tricks. I think she has a lot of tricks in her upper sleeve. Let's share them. Please go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for kind introduction. And I will not take so much time and on the basic slides. Just I share bowel preparation for the TLH. That is 2 tablets Dulcolax and 4 tablets Gasex in the night, previous night, is more than sufficient. And last 10 years, we are just following this technique only and not using any Paglite and anything else. So 2 tablets Dulcolax and 4 tablets Gasex is enough. For the anesthesia, we are using only general anesthesia, but many centers are using combined anesthesia also. I will not go in detail of the things because there is a little short of the time. And for the position, when we talk, so that is the 30-degree flexion of the legs and buttocks are just on extending on the table. So we can actually manipulate the manipulator better. And I will just skip these things. And we are using this is port position. We are using this 4 port, 3 5mm port and 1 central port, and this is 10mm port. We are putting just 2 fingers above the umbilicus, and this is actually routinely placing in the normal size uterus. If the size of the uterus is bigger, then we shift this upper port toward the epigastrium. And while putting the secondary tocar, we have to always see for the inferior epigastric vessel, which is forefinger lateral to the midline. So you can see for the inferior epigastric artery, you can see it is visible here, medial to this lateral umbilical ligament. And for the tocar placement, you can see we are using this direct tocar technique, and this is the safety tocar. It is a larger version of the varies needle-like thing. And we are just holding, and just by the screwing movement, we are going in. So this is the simplest technique to place the tocar inside. And this is actually grown inside, and we feel a click when we will inside. So just checking, and I don't think it needs much more time. So primary entry, we can put Palmer's point also if the previous cesarean case also, or we can use the Jain point also. And these are the instrument, and we are using this Indian manipulator for manipulating the uterus. And you can see this is a straight long rod, and this is a vaginal tube, and these are the silicone tube which actually fit in the vagina to open. This is the vessel sealer which we are using. Energy sources, there is a lot of debate on what should use, what should not be used, and we can use NC Liga, Sure Harmony, and Indian bipolar vessel sealer also. Anything you have which is cost effective and beneficial, you can use that. This is just how to place the uterine manipulator. We are just taking the uterocervical length with the dilator, and according to the length of this manipulator, uterocervical length, we can fix the top attachment of the manipulator. This is the uterine attachment, which are small, medium, and long length. So you can just fit according to the size of the uterus, and this is the fitting of the cervical hook over the cervix, which is this manipulator have. So you can see we have this attached along the according to the size of the uterus, and just by the screwing movement we can go inside. So after placing all the manipulators and trocars, we are ready to do our hysterectomy. And we like to start from the upper pedicle, and we are using this bipolar shearer, which is Indian made instrument, and this is very cost effective and easy to use. And first taking the uterine, this fallopian tube, then ovarian pedicle. And for coagulating with this instrument, we have to actually complete taking the all the tissue inside the jaw. Then we can actually seal it, and then taking half of the tissue in the jaw, then we can cut it. And there is bipolar coagulation cutting, both the things are there. So after taking pedicle, we are just opening the broad ligament leaf, anterior and posterior. And there should be the swapping movement only. If you are moving like this way, you can face this kind of the small bleeding also. So just taking anterior leaf of the broad ligament, and your manipulation of the from vaginal end is very important, because it is in harmony with the surgeon. Now we are just lifting the UV fold to separate the bladder, and you can see this bubble plane, and this is champagne effect. When we lifting the UV fold, you can see there is a getting plane. This is the benefit of the laparoscopy. When we lift the UV fold and the gas goes inside in the plane and making, helping us in the making the plane. And Dr. Kuntambikar has cleared very well the anatomy. So you can actually see the fat belongs to the bladder, fat belongs to the rectum also. And so always when dissecting the bladder, you have to keep down your instrument below the fat and always work in the plane. And one tip is for the lifting the bladder is you lift all the fibers of the bladder. Don't pull only the peritoneum. You pull the only peritoneum, then it will not lift. So you can see I'm just lifting completely the fibers. When you lift, so you can see this kind of the vertical fibers. These are the bladder fibers. So you can just dissect them with the bipolar cutting current and without damaging anything. And it, so just pulling and pushing effect, we can just separate the bladder very well. And this is giving little difficulty in while the cases of previous cesarean or previous surgery. So Dr. Meenakshi will take care of the part key, how to dissect bladder in the previous surgery cases. This is a simple case. So we have completely dissected the bladder. You can see this is the cervix and this is the lower limit of the cervix. So we have to dissect up till the lower limit of the cervix. And while taking the pedicle, you have to be a little bit careful because there is vessels in the these bladder pillars. And there is a ureter also running below the bladder. So you can see the we have pushed the ring inside. And this is the vaginal ring. And we have separated bladder well down. Now we are taking right side pedicle in the same manner. So I'm just forwarding it. And now we are taking the uterine artery on the right side. Now you can just see we have changed the instrument from the left port to the right side port. Dr. Deepak Limbache is calling just. Yeah. So we have changed our this instrument in the right port because to take the uterine, it should be on the 90 degree. Because if you take the any vessel on the 90 degree, it will actually take complete uterine diameter in the instrument. If you are taking like this way parallel to the vessel, then it will not take completely in the vessels of the in the instrument jaw. Now we are taking on the left side uterine artery, and before taking the uterine artery, we are just separating the posterior peritoneum till the uterosacral ligament. This is actually decreasing the bulk while coagulating the tissue. So you can just skeletonize. So bulk of the tissue decreases and it comes properly fit in the jaw of the instrument. You can actually use the bipolar first and then also cut with the sealer also, or you can directly cut like I am cutting. But there may be little bleeding if not sealed properly. So we are just dissecting it properly, and now you can see I'm just little forwarding it, and so just giving traction from the corneal end. Now we are just taking the uterine artery, so sealing it at 3 point at the base and then near to the uterus to decrease the backflow. If you are not taking this proximal clamp, then there may be the chances of bleeding from the uterine side. So we are just coagulating. So you can just coagulate at the 3 point and cut the uterines. So you can see I have cut, and now we are taking just parallel to the cervix to taking the McEnroe's ligament, and we are taking small bites and taking care of the coagulation also, bleeding also. So you can see we have just enough below this manipulator ring. This vaginal ring is a guidance to us how low we should go. Because if we are going down, then there may be the chances of injury to the ureter, and there may be the thermal spread to the ureter also. So we should not dissect much down below the McEnroe's. And just after taking the McEnroe's, there is a pinkish structure coming, then we have to stop ourselves. So a ring is completely pushed inside, and the silicone ring is also pushed in the vagina to prevent the pneumo leak. Now we are just cutting the vault with the monopolar hook, and we are using pure cut current. We are not using any coagulation here. Pure cut current is helpful in cutting like a knife only without damaging the vaginal tissue, because if you are using more current here and the lots of the sharing is there, then there may be chances of sloughing of the tissue, and you know, suture the vaginal wall, and there may be chances of vaginal wall dehiscence if you are using much of the most energy. So we have preferred to use only cutting current, pure cutting current, and with hook only. And if there is a little bit bleeder, we can take with the bipolar precisely after cutting all the complete circle, because this time there may be little ooze, and I prefer little oozy vault always, because it gives a better healing than the dried, white and charred vault. Because many a time for the demonstrating purpose, we actually do the complete bloodless surgery, and this bloodless surgery actually many time harmful to the patient at this point. So always use cutting current to cut the vault, and specifically take care of the bleeding point if any is there. So we are just little for first. Oh, come on, shuru mein aaye vapas. So it is just completion of vault. Now we just pull out all this assembly out, and we can just take out the system out, and the uterus is delivered out. Uterus is delivered out here. Yes. So we can use this uterus back inside the vagina also. So to use the as it prevention of the pneumoleak, and taking out both the tubes here to prevent the chances of any ovarian cancer or any ovarian pathology. Now we will suture the vault with the number one Vicryl. We are just using number one Vicryl 45 centimeter only, just inserting the needle, and direct insertion of the needle is always easiest method to insert the needle inside. And while suturing the vault, always take the bite through the uterosacral ligament while taking the angle of the vault. It will help in suspending the vault completely and help in prevention of the future vault prolapse. And while taking the suture, it should be full thickness of the vaginal wall. So I'm just little fast forwarding. It was actually a 17 minute video, but because of a short of time, I'm just fast forwarding. So we are just taking the full thickness bite through the both the anterior and posterior vaginal wall, and we are taking continuous suture without any interlocking suture, and tie at the other end. So we have just completed the suturing, and you can notice we have taken the bite through the uterosacral ligament here. So it is just completion and taking the two throws, and you can observe we have using one tooth needle holder and one non tooth needle holder. Both the needle holder helps in fast suturing and not handling. So you can see we have just completed our procedure, and it is very easy procedure, and everybody can do it, and just following the ureter here. So just for demonstration purpose, and anytime you complete the surgery, you can just look for the ureter, because they should be very friendly to us. So it is completed the video, and it is just a small demonstration of taking out the larger specimen vaginally. One tip only for removing through the vaginal end like this: keep giving the cut from 12 o'clock to 6 o'clock half portion, and then just rotate it. You can see we are just rotating the specimen. Because of rotation, there is a new surface coming in front for cutting. So this way, cutting and rotation, cutting and rotation, cutting full thickness from anterior to posterior. This is the only tip to take out, making the ribbon. So you can see how much long ribbon is there, and we have removed a 5.5 feet long strip also. So I am not going in this we remove the catheter after 4 hours or overnight in the morning only. So thank you so much for patience hearing, and thank you all of the delegates to join the 6th Raj Endogyny update and making the event successful. Thank you all the faculty members for being with us and joining all the time on my request. And thank you, Dr. Dinesh Kansal ma'am, just accepting my request for chairing the session. Thank you so much, ma'am. Yes.
You muted me and unmuting. Thank you, Dr. Sushila. It was so wonderful. You started with all the details right from manipulator and the uterine arteries being taken perpendicularly and how the vault is to be fixed to the uterus cycle so well. I'm glad you are such a good teacher. I think you've got students everywhere from your center. And congratulations for the wonderful presentation and the beautiful conference as a whole. Should we go to the next speaker now? We have Dr. Pandit Palaskar with us, who is President Aurangabad Society and Joint Secretary IAGE, and he's been operating faculty at most of the operating workshop, a quiet person and a wonderful surgeon. He will be talking on large uterus and TLH. I think there was a question in the chat box about 20 weeks uterus. I think Dr. Pandit Palaskar would take care of that also. Dr. Pandit, please. Please share your screen.
Dr. Pandit Palaskar. Yeah. Sir, please share your screen.
Yeah, I'm sharing.
Come, sir.
Yeah. Hi, good afternoon.
Please share your screen, sir.
Yeah, I'm sharing. Can you see my screen?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, we are seeing your screen.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Sushila Saini and Rajasthan chapter of Gynae Endoscopy for giving me this opportunity, and thanks again Dr. Dinesh Kansal madam for your kind words. I'll be talking on the total laparoscopic hysterectomy for the large uterus. Can you see my screen?
Yes, you can make it full. Yes.
Yeah, laparoscopic hysterectomy is the most commonly performed gynecological surgery. It was first performed by Haririch in 1989, and since that it has been performed with slight changes in the techniques and the tools. Everybody knows laparoscopic hysterectomy gives many advantages, like it is minimally invasive, it gives less pain, causes less blood loss, less chances of infection. Patient has to stay for a short period in the hospital, and she can resume her duties earlier. Now, coming to the topic, to the large uterus, I think the large uterus, it depends, it is an individual consideration. It depends on the surgeon's experience and his surgery team of experience of the surgical team and the availability of the infrastructure. Most studies, they have set an upper limit of uterus around 16 weeks. But it entirely depends on the experience of the surgical team. This is an article by our own Dr. Rakesh Sinha, which also says total laparoscopy hysterectomy for large uterus is technically feasible and it can be performed by the experienced surgeon regardless of the size, number, and the location of the fibroids. So large size is not a contraindication for the laparoscopic hysterectomy. This is another article which also says what is the limit. I think the size of the uterus does not seem to be an absolute contraindication for endoscopic surgery, and this procedure entirely depends on the surgeon's ability. So there is no upper limit. You can start with the small uterus. You can move to the 16 weeks, 18 weeks, 24 weeks, 32 weeks, and large uterus depending on your expertise and the ability. Large uterus can be due to uterine fibroids. It can be located in the body of the uterus, intramural or subserous. They could be broad ligament fibroids, cervical fibroid, or adenomyosis leading to the enlargement of the uterus. So what are the difficulties with the large uterus? Main problem is with the poor access and exposure to the uterine pedicles. So these are the main concerns. There can be limited access to the uterine vascular pedicles depending on the size and the location of the myomas. It can lead to the distortion of the normal anatomy of the uterus, leading to the distorted anatomy of the ureters and the uterine pedicles. When you are dealing with such types of the uteruses, there is a high risk of complications like hemorrhage. There can be risk of injury to the bowel and urinary tract due to the poor exposure. You may have difficulty in extracting the uteruses like this, and overall it can lead to the longer operative procedure. So patient can have other problems like hypercarbia, anesthesia risk, and coagulation problems. So whenever you are dealing with patients with large uteruses, you have to do the proper preoperative evaluation of the patient. Apart from the history, you have to do the proper clinical examination. You have to note the size of the uterus. There is the exact location of the fibroid, whether the uterus is mobile or not, because it is going to make difference. When the uterus is fixed, probably you are dealing with the patients with the adenomyosis and the endometriosis, and that surgery is going to be difficult. Ultrasound, MRI, and CT scan has to be done to know the what is the exact etiology, and every attempt has to be made. You are not dealing with the malignancy, because in few cases there can be hidden malignancy, and every attempt has to be made to identify it. And apart from this, you have to do the proper anesthesia evaluation, ECG, 2D echo from the fitness point of view. Again, the counseling of the patient and relatives is very important. You have to explain the benefits, the risks, and the complications associated with the surgery, other methods of the treatment with their advantages and disadvantages. And you have to also explain and take the consent for the rare chance of conversion to the laparotomy whenever there is problem, there is bleeding, or there is some intraoperative problem. You have to complete the procedure by doing the laparotomy. And consent regarding this should be taken when you are dealing with the large uteruses. Bowel preparation, as usual, we give dulcolase gases prior evening. In simple cases, we don't give this ethylene glycol, only we give in the complicated cases for the bowel preparation. We need to have good teamwork, gynec, good anesthetist, intensive GI surgeon, urosurgeon. Whenever you have difficulty, you can take help of these people. Again, whenever you are dealing with the large uteruses, difficult hysterectomy, you need to be very clear regarding the pelvic anatomy, because whenever there is large uterus, there will be altered pelvic anatomy of the uterine pedicles, ureters, bladder, the vessels. They will be engorged, and you have to be ready to tackle these engorged vessels. So you have to be clear regarding the distorted anatomy in such cases, in patients with broad ligament fibroid, cervical fibroid. You need to have good knowledge of the pelvic anatomy while you are operating such cases. You need to have good vaginal trolley with large speculums to retrieve the specimens, laparoscopic trolley, manipulators. In large uteruses, more than 20 weeks, the manipulator may not help. In those cases, you have to take the help of the myoma screw to manipulate the uterus. You have to select the manipulator according to the size of the uterus. We use these simple manipulators. Small uteruses, we use small manipulator. For big uteruses, we use this type of manipulator to handle the uterus. Now, we have to follow certain tips during the hysterectomy. For the large uteruses, we have to do the proper placement of the port. Whenever the uterus, the placement of the port will be according to the size of the uterus, and there should be at least 5 to 8 centimeter distance from the pathology to the port, so that the movement of the instruments in the peritoneal cavity will be easier. In difficult cases, you can use contralateral ports, because it may be difficult to pass the instrument from the ipsilateral port to the other side of the uterus. You can do the internatural ligation at the origin to reduce the blood loss, and you need to have good teamwork. This is our port placement. It depends. Usually, in large cases, we do the supraumbilical port and the side port according to the size of the uterus. It goes upwards as the size of the uterus increases. Now, we'll see the some cases of the laparoscopic hysterectomy. This is the uterus around 18 to 20 weeks. You can see the uterus is enlarged due to the fibroid uterus. So in this case, the primary port was inserted at least 4 to 5 centimeters above the umbilicus, and we started with the coronal ligation of the pedicles. So there is no much problem when you are dealing with upper pedicles, only the uterine pedicles, they should be taken properly either by suturing or by using the good sealing devices or other techniques. Here you can see we have done the dissection on the right side. The coronals are taken from in from above downward direction till the bladder. This is a dissection on the left side. The bladder is dissected sufficiently. These are the coronals on the left side. The assistant is holding and retracting the ovary on the other side. Now after the proper skeletonization of the uterine pedicle, the uterines, they are coagulated and cut. Whenever the uterine are large, you can take the help of the ligatures because these energy sources may not be sufficient to tackle the engorged uterines. Then the colpotomy is done as usual. The vaginal tube is put inside the vagina to demarcate the junction between the uterus and the vagina. Colpotomy is done either by the harmonic, or you can use this monopolar, or you can use scissor also to do the colpotomy. Then these tube and ovary is removed depending on the age of the patient and niche of the patient. You can see most of the large uteruses we remove by the vaginal morcellation. Only in few cases in patients with previous 2-3 LSAs when the vagina is narrow, in patients with nulliparous, morbidly obese patient, in those patients we remove the uterus by power morcellation. Otherwise, most of the cases up to 20 weeks we can remove by the vaginal morcellation. Then the wall support is given with the help of the uterus sacral. The first suture always go through the uterus sacral to attach it to the angles of the vagina. So the incidence of the wall prolapse is reduced to the great extent. You can see the wall is approximated, hemostasis is checked, and the procedure is good. Now we'll see the different cases of the large uteruses. These are the two cases. In one case, you can see the left broad ligament fibroid. In the right lower case, you can see the right broad ligament multiple fibroid distorting the pelvic anatomy. Yeah, whenever we are dealing with the broad ligament fibroid, we have to take care that you have to be clear in mind there will be a distorted pelvic anatomy. So the course of the ureter need to be traced, and the ureter need to be protected from the pelvic ring till the insertion of the bladder. In this case, you can see the incision is taken on the superior aspect of the broad ligament fibroid, and it is hooked with the Myma screw, and it is removed by the traction and counter traction. Initially, at the beginning of the surgery, course of the ureter, we ascertain that the ureter is lying at the base of this fibroid, and the fibroid is removed by traction and counter traction. And here, the course of the ureter is traced from the pelvic rim up to its insertion into the bladder. You can see the course of the uterine artery. And once the fibroid is removed, then the rest of the hysterectomy was continued as usual. In this case also, the course of the ureter was identified and the rest of the hysterectomy was completed. Now this is another case with left broad ligament fibroid. You can see the broad ligament fibroid is arising from the lateral aspect of the uterus, and it is extending into the broad ligament and anteriorly up to the cervix. Again, in this case, we have to be very careful regarding the course of the ureter, because as this fibroid is arising above the level of the uterine artery, the ureter is definitely going to lie at its base and it will be pushed laterally. So after coronal ligaments, they are coagulated and cut, the lateral pelvic wall is open and the course of the ureter is identified. the course of the uterine artery and the internal iliac is identified and the uterine artery is taken at its origin. You can see the uterine artery after coagulation and cut, it is pulled medially and the ureter is lateralized. Then the other sided coronal structures are coagulated and cut. The skeletonization of the uterine artery is done on the right side. You can see this broad ligament fibroid is also extending anteriorly toward the cervix and the vagina. And you can see the bladder is stretched out over the broad ligament fibroid. The bladder is dissected and pushed down. At this time, the vaginal assistant is asked to push the uterus and cervix in the upward direction, so the traction is maintained and you get more space to operate in this region. You can see this is bladder is completely pushed down sufficiently, and then the uterine artery is, the uterine artery on the right side is taken, pulpotomy is done, and the uterus is removed, and the rest of the hysterectomy is completed. Now this is a patient with cervical uterine fibroid along with the cervical fibroid. Again, in this case, the anatomy of the uterine artery and the ureter will be displayed. So you have to trace the course of the ureter in this case also. You have to start from the pelvic, these coronal pedicles as usual, and uterine manipulator is put so that the assistant pushes to the opposite direction so that you get more space. Here you can see it is the anterior wall cervical fibroid and the uterus is sitting on its top. So once the bladder is dissected, the uterus along with the fibroid is pushed upwards and the anatomy of the ureter is identified. To identify the anatomy of the ureter, you have to dissect from the pelvic ring. Here you can see the ureter is traversing. The uterine artery is lying on its roof. The uterine artery is taken at its origin. This is a little old video with poor quality. And you can see the course of the ureter. You can see the ureter is abutting the fibroid. The course of the ureter is identified on both sides. Then the pulpotomy is done and the uterus is removed out. Now this is a patient with quite large uterus. You can see it is completely occupying the peritoneal cavity up to the GP sternum. And so in these cases, you have to be very careful. The primary port is almost at the level of the GP sternum. And after insertion of the primary port, you have to see the complete anatomy of the pelvis and the upper abdomen. And there is usually very less space and it is difficult to manipulate the uterus. And in this case, you have to take the help of the manipulator as well as the Myma screw to move the uterus to the opposite direction when you are taking the coronal pedicles and the uterines. So in these cases, you have to use the different multiple ports. When you are dealing with the coronal pedicles, you have to use the upper ports. When you are coming to the vault and the uterine level, you can use the lower ports. So you have to start as usual, like routine hysterectomy. Take the coronals, then open the broad ligament, dissect the bladder, and first ligate the uterine vessels. Once the uterine pedicles are ligated, the blood supply to the uterus is cut, and whatever blood is there, only the collected blood will come down, out. So you can see the tortuous vessels. One important thing when you are dealing with large uteruses like this, you can take the advantage of the contralateral port. See, this bipolar is coming from the opposite side and the scissor is coming from the lower port. So you can use the space that is there in the lower pelvis, and in whatever way you are comfortable, you can put the instrument from the lower port or contralateral port and you can do the procedure. Here the uterine is tackled by using the left lateral port and the right sided lower port by doing the contralateral port suturing. As the uterine is very much engorged and dilated, it is very difficult to tackle with the energy sources like harmonic or this bipolar. So it was sutured on the left side. On the right side, the course of the internal iliac is stressed and the origin of the internal uterine artery is identified and it was ligated at its origin. Now once the vascular pedicle is taken care of. The rest of the procedure is just doing the debulking of the fibroid, and it is not going to cause much problem, because whether you morcellate for half hour or 1 hour, it is not going to cause problem, because there is no blood loss. And the most dangerous thing while taking these cases is hemorrhage. So once the vascular pedicles are secured, there is no much worry. The job is almost 90% over. In these cases, you can see, as the uterus is large, there is a lot of the blood collected and backflow comes from keeping in, and it can cause accumulation of the blood in the peritoneal cavity. The colpotomy is done. As this uterus is very large, it was not possible to morcellate it vaginally, so it was removed by laparoscopic method. The vault is closed. Vault closure was done with taking the support of the uterosacral ligaments, and it was morcellated. It took at least 1 hour to morcellate this large uterus. But as the uterus was firm and there was no much necrosis of the fibroid, it was removed with large strips. All precautions should be taken while doing morcellation. The morcellated blade should be under vision. You should avoid the touching to the bowel loops, all those things. They should be, all these precautions should be followed while doing morcellation. The morcellation was quite easy, and the fibroid was weighing almost 3.2 kg. And this is the final outcome. Subtotal hysterectomy can be needed in while you are dealing with a difficult situation. Whenever there is a anatomic distortion and there is concern of blood loss, first you can do the supracervical hysterectomy, and you can do the morcellation you can detach the specimen, and the rest of the cervix can be removed in the subsequent step. So it can be done in certain cases. Difficult cases, you can do certain modifications in the technique. Mimectomy can be done to get the more space. In case of large cervical fibroid, uterine ligation, as we have done in this case, can be done at the origin from the internal iliac. Supracervical hysterectomy after securing the uterine pedicles can be done. Or you can do the direct morcellation of the uterus after taking the uterine artery in order to debulk the specimen and to get the more space for the movement of the operative instruments. Now the other step comes in the removal of the large uteruses. In almost 90-95% of the cases, we remove these large uteruses by vaginal morcellation. Only in patients with a very narrow cervix, previous 3 caesarean section, when the cervix is narrow, nulliparous, in those patients only the power morcellation can be done, or you can remove these uteruses by making a suprapubic incision and taking out the specimen. Now these are the vaginal morcellation techniques. There are different vaginal morcellation techniques. Dr. Sushila has already shown in small uterus case up to 12 weeks.